behind, so we will have lunch at 12:45. And it's now turn to start with our tutorials. You've noticed that we have three kinds of general kinds of talks, and the tutorial ones are the ones that we really mean for everyone to be accessible. And it's it should have been Massimo giving the first tutorial, but as you all know, he's unwell in Milano at the moment, so he's being replaced at the very last minute by Fabio, who will just start his tutorial now. So please, Fabio.
Okay, so first you can imagine the wait, right? The room, replacing Massimo, I mean, is more than normally one can stand. But so let's start talking about candies and sausages, okay? So first, think for a second to a candy and a sausage and decide what you like best, okay? So I will count three and you will have decided whether you want now a sausage or a candy. Good. And now, to get your sausage, it's not that I will hand you a sausage. Remember, your aim you have in mind, sausage, sausage, sausage. So you are aiming at a sausage, but I'm not giving you the sausage. I'm telling you, look, you can have your sausage either by flipping a coin, which is fair, and will give you a sausage with probability 1/2. Or you can play with, pick somebody you don't know who's sitting here. So you don't know her, you don't know her tastes, okay? And you are playing this matching sausage thing. And so you can say, look, I will go for black or white. And if you match what she's saying, you will have a candy, and if you don't match, you will have a sausage. Remember, the ghost is sitting there. Okay? And now, well, again, you want sausage, and you have to choose this or this. Okay? Ways of getting your sausage. So remember, it's not that you have a preference for a strategy or another. The thing is sausage or candy. Okay, that's the framework I'm going to talk about. And I need you to know two things. What is a game in normal form? And if you don't, to have a game in normal form, you should also put here what the ghost is getting. But since it's ghost food, you don't see it. And you should know what is the weak axiom of revealed preference. If you don't, I mean, with an axe of strength, we will turn the blackboard and it's written behind the blackboard. Okay? Very well. We can start. Do you all know what the weak axiom is? Otherwise, we can just turn the blackboard.
Actually, it's a nice.
So weak axiom of revealed preference. I mean, it's not that we are showing off. This thing doesn't turn. So weak axiom of revealed preference is an axiom. I mean, now you are imagining somebody who is picking his chosen food out of a tray, and the tray is the set of all trays is denoted by that. Each tray is denoted by capital script B, and this function tells you if I give Eichel tray B, he will pick the food gamma B. Okay, so first gamma B must be a subset of B because he cannot pick food which is not in the tray. And second, if there is a tray A which is smaller than tray B, and if the intersection between A and what he chooses, assume for a second, he just choose one chunk of food. And what he choose, and the intersection between the smaller tray and what he chooses in the big tray is non-empty, then he will just choose what he used to choose, and he will not substitute with something else. Okay? And this is the way in which Arrow depicts rationality of a consumer. Okay? So, I mean, basically, in economic theory, there have been a very important debate. I will not talk about it, about what are preferences. One way of answering is what you can get when you look at choices. Looking at choices means looking at this choice correspondence that take a tray, what the decision maker picks out of the tray. Okay, now we can really start. Okay, very well. Okay, how do I make it, this way? No, si vede bene. Perché mi sembra che sia tutto sfocato. Si vede? Can you see the screen? Because from here is strange. Okay. Okay, very well. So basically, we are talking about, we have to turn it for a last time. So we are talking about decision problems. What is a decision problem? A decision problem is this one, okay? So you have to pick a course of action. The outcome of the course of action depends on environmental factors that you don't control, and the matching of what you do and what environment does determines the outcome. Morally, you care about the outcome, okay? Very well. And this is, part of a joint paper with, everybody sitting in the room except Massimo. Okay. No, not sitting, but okay. So, since this is a tutorial, there are things you must read if you want to understand the modern theory of decision making under uncertainty. Okay? It's not that you must read them to understand what I'm gonna say, but these are just beautiful works. So Einstein and Milner, yes, is the Field Medal, the Milner guy there, is basically the first beautiful representation theorem that consider the case in which you're not choosing objects like this, but rather objects like that. Okay? Kuhn is very, very, yes, is the Kuhn of the Kuhn-Tucker conditions. Kuhn basically informed the thing that we are doing because of sausages. What you care is the end of the tree. You don't have a preference for strategies, per se, but because you care about realization. I will not be more clear than that. Savage is the father of all of us, and tackled uncertainty. You will see how and why. Milner, again, yes, is the Milner over there, conceived this kind of decision problem, this kind of decision problems as a game, and we will see this at the end. I will not make it to that. Luce and Raifa gave that kind of formalism to decision problems. And then Raifa started quarreling about Ellsberg on whether you should, if you really want the sausage, you should go this way or this way. How many of you were indifferent between the two ways of getting their sausage? 1, 2 indifferent, 3 indifferent, 4 indifferent, 5 indifferent, 6, 7. Okay, not all of you. Okay? And then Ascombe-Aumann and Marshall-Kradner, this one is a paper, the other is a book. Ascombe-Aumann is the paper that settled the mathematical standards of the modern approach to decision making. We are not taking the modern one, we are taking the older ones. And Ascombe-Aumann and Marshall-Kradner, well, you will see. Okay, so these are all very classical papers and books. No, this one. Okay, so let's consider another decision problem under uncertainty. So in this problem, you get to the kitchen your wife is doing something else, and she tells you, look, there is an omelette over there. I just put the eggs. There is just one. Finish the omelette. And you know that you are in trouble, right? Because you will do something wrong, and she will get mad at you. So you can either throw the egg away, or you can break it into a bowl, right? Once you break it into a bowl, once you decide to break it, that is to use the egg rather than just tossing it away without pretending, so you can break it right into the casserole, there are already 5 eggs there, or break it into a saucer. Question is, why should you break it into the saucer? Well, you should break it into the saucer because if the egg is good, you will have a 6-egg omelette, but a saucer to wash. But this is especially important if the egg is rotten, because if the egg is rotten, then the 5 eggs your wife already broke into the casserole are safe, right? If you break it right away into the casserole, the egg is rotten and you are in trouble. Okay? Very well. So this is a famous... this is the way in which Savage 54 introduced... this is the story used to introduce a decision problem, and this is the decision problem it shows. A decision problem that tells you, look, there is this fancy tree. In his case, it was not a tree, it was a story. There is this fancy story, and we can always transform a story into a matrix where there are what he called acts and states. For example, this act is the act he called break into casserole, and it gives you 6-egg omelette or nothing, depending on whether the egg is good or not, and you can see the other questions. But when you write the decision strategies of your guy, you realize that actually Savage is basically coalescing 2 strategies into 1 line. What are these 2 strategies? The 2 strategies, throw away, and in case you have to break it, break it into the casserole, and throw away, and in case you have to break it into the saucer. Of course, Glenn said, look, this is not the way to go, right? Savage one is the way to go, because if you decide to throw it away, end of the game. Questions? Okay, notice that actually it doesn't matter whether you take the Pascal or Fermat thing, because irrespectively of the states, these 2 strategies lead, exactly like in the Fermat versus Pascal case, to the same outcomes. Okay, and this, one way in which you can attribute this kind of coalescing reasoning into Savage views is that he writes, look, if 2 different acts had the same consequences in every state of the world, there would be no point in considering them 2 different acts at all. Okay, so then he concludes, or more formally, an act is a function that attaches consequences to states. Okay? Do you see functions on the board? Well, Savage did, and in a smart but not especially smart way, he said, look, if your choice of throwing the egg away is a function that to every state attaches an outcome. Okay, again, your choice of breaking it into a casserole is a function that to every state associates an outcome, okay? So Savage 2 started from a decision problem, but immediately said the thing that you would call actions, break and the thing that you would call decision, decide to break and into the casserole, decide to throw away, are immediately mapped into functions that determine the outcomes in the various states. Okay, but the important thing is that to do so, you have to make these 2 things equivalent. Okay, because otherwise they would be 2 different actions and they would induce the same function. Question? And of course, if you think of any game in extensive form, whenever you write the normal form, what happens is that you have lines and lines that are equal, right? And in general, you have payoffs, and you do some reduction with payoffs. Notice that here we don't have payoffs at this stage. Eh? We have sausages, candies, omelets, and so on. Okay. So let's get a bit formal, just the minimum required. Okay. So now, what is a decision framework? Is a quartet. Is a set A of actions. What are the actions? Are little b and little w. Look there. Okay? Then a set of states. What are the states? Are capital B and capital W over there. So actions are the thing you control. States is the thing the ghost controls. Okay? A set of consequences. What are consequences? Candies and sausages. Okay? Material consequences. And what is rho? Rho is the matrix I draw. It's the function that tells you, given an action and a state, those two together determine, through rho, a consequence. Okay? So it's the consequence function, which there, again, is just the map that brings this cell of the product into a candy, into a sausage, into a candy, into a sausage. Okay, so this is a decision framework under uncertainty. This way of framing it was done in words, very explicitly, but just in words, by Luce and Reifer. But they immediately say, and then you replace candies and sausages with money. Okay, I'm being brutal, but basically that's what they say. And they never write, they never paint, maybe it was a technological constraint, sausages and candies, but they just put numbers over there. Okay, remember that up to now, we are thinking of sausages. While the guys that really wrote this formally were Marsha Keradner, actually in the same years, in the 50s, but then the book came out in the 70s. Okay. So what is all the Savage thing I was bothering you with is the following. Savage say, an act is a function from states to consequences, right? While we are saying an action is an action, and let's see what. So what Savage does is basically taking the section with respect to A of the function rho. What is the section with respect to A of the function rho? The section is just putting a hand here and say, forget about the rest. Okay, section means looking at this rho, which is then a function from states to consequences. He's taking the section, in fact, he say, an act is a function attaching a consequence to each state. Okay, but then it may be the case that two different actions, think of the last two lines in the previous slide, give you the same section. That is to say, they give you the same act. If you are consequentialist, meaning you care about sausages and candies and not about the name or the way you have to go to get your sausage or your sandwich, or your candy, the time is failing me. So then, whenever you have two actions that in every state give you the same consequence, you should, and here let me put quotes and quotes and quotes, you should be indifferent between these two actions. Why should you? Because if you weren't, it would mean that there is some other consequence that you are not writing, but that matters to you. Okay. For example, assume that you go to your account, to your bank, and you tell, look, I want to invest this money. And they tell you, look, you have these two bonds. They give you exactly the same payoff. The risk profile of these two, of the two issuers is exactly the same. One issuer is in France, the other issuer is in Belgium. Okay, so if you really prefer one over the other, it means that there is some consequence that you are not writing. One consequence is, for example, that for you matters helping the Belgian government rather than the French one. Okay, so, but if you write the problem properly and consequences, so that the things that you care, you call them consequences, then assumption over there seems reasonable. Okay, think of the sausage again, because that's the thing. If what you care there is sausage or candy, if two actions give you in every state the same thing, they should be indifferent. Okay. We will work under this assumption for the reason I just said. There are interesting things to say when this assumption is violated, and I will not talk about them. So we will say that a decision framework is reduced if we already went through the process of coalescing lines that give you the same section. Okay, mathematically is a passing to the quotient. Brutally is just a chopping of lines that give you the same row. Okay. So now, what is, at this point, this is an embedding, meaning that this function is one-to-one. To every action, you associate uniquely an element of the space of functions from S to C. Okay? It's an embedding because there are no two lines that have the same rows attached. Okay, these are the acts that are conceivable. And should you ask a question now or shouldn't you? Well, I think you should. What does it mean, conceivable? Conceivable here means that in this decision framework, they will think of a simpler decision, a very simple decision framework with just one state, where you have to choose about bundles of apples and bananas. Okay? What are the conceivable bundles? Well, it depends. For example, if you are Glenn, you would say the positive octant because apples and bananas are infinitely divisible. If you are me, I would say the lattice of entire apples or bananas. These are the bundles that are conceivable. What will your budget say set? Your budget set say? Well, it depends on the money you have in your pocket. Okay, so keep in mind this distinction. Actions that are conceivable, all the possible tuples, apples, and banana, and that are feasible, those that you can afford. Okay, this will be important in talking about the things we are talking. So, by A, I will mean the set of conceivable actions. Well, it depends on you. For example, I will give you an example. It will definitely depend on the problem. And let me make you this example. In this case, it is difficult for me to conceive an action that will give me a 5-egg omelette if the egg is good, and a 6-egg omelette if the egg is rotten. But I might not conceive it. You might conceive it saying, look, I will strike a contract with Eichel saying that we make a little hole, we sip a bit of the egg, and if the egg is bad, he will give me that, and otherwise I will give him that. I mean, it depends on how much you want to stretch your brain on the opportunities. And then, of course, once you have conceived it, it's an entirely different game whether you can implement it. But conceivability is basically, if you ask me, first, it depends on the problem. Second, is the things that you can write down practically. If you're really facing a problem, is all the things you can write down, maybe not alone, maybe after talking to somebody else, because you can say, look, I don't know what to do with this egg. And then your daughter tells you, but Dad, go ask Fabio. You see, so is as much as you can stretch, you will see the good thing is that it will be, given conceivability, something will happen. So basically, it will be a datum in general of the problem for us. I mean, for the real decision maker, it will be something he will construct. Okay, other questions? Okay, Marshak and Radner say, look, to measure how much you like outcomes and what you think about the likelihood of states. Remember, there are three things: actions you choose, states ghost chooses, consequences, the thing you care about. If I want to measure how do you like the things you like, first. And if I want to measure what is your likelihood assessment between what can happen and you don't control, I must be able, and this in a sense goes back to what Glenn was saying before, I must be able to see you betting, okay? So I must make you conceive bets that tell you, look, if something happens, you will get this outcome. If something else happens, you will get this consequence. If something else will happen, you just two outcomes, binary. A bet is just, I'm talking about very simple bet. If a subset of S happen, you get one outcome. If it doesn't, you get another outcome. For example, this is an example of conceivability. Can you conceive of betting? If you can conceive of betting, you are automatically in a Mars chakra. If you can think of betting about the consequences, you are. Notice that there are, in practice, there are many cases in which people really don't want to conceive betting. Think, betting on somebody you love being sick, you just don't want to conceive it, okay? And of course, there is all this discussion about state-dependent utility and so on and so forth. Again, this is important, it can always be embedded in this case, but this, I mean, I will not assume throughout that you can conceive betting, but I will assume it a lot. It will be important for the uniqueness of the result, it will be completely unimportant for the existence result, okay? But anyway, so that we have a language. So, our language, just to fix ideas again, it will not always be required, but our language is a set of actions, a set of what you control, a set of states, what you don't control, a set of consequences, what you care, the matrix mapping what you choose and what nature does into a consequence, and you will assume that you can think of betting. Okay? Formally, what does it mean? It means that when you take the sections, all the binary functions on the consequences you are caring about are there. Okay? Mixing. So, the discussion between Ellsberg and the discussion between Ellsberg and Raifa was already hidden in what Raifa thought before reading Ellsberg's paper and what motivated the Simone's indifference between those two things. Okay? Because the idea is that in general, what happened in general here is that you don't know what the ghost will choose, right? And if you don't know, and assume that the ghost always goes capital W, then basically if you choose, assume that you care about the sausage, if you choose white, you are doomed. Okay? So to put it a bit more formally, is the reason why some of you might have preferred the coin is because you didn't know the probability of black, capital black and capital white on the matrix. Okay, so this is an explanation, I don't know, I will interview during lunch, but so this is the thing, okay? But very smartly, Raifa put this argument, he say, look, don't worry, toss a coin in your pocket, okay? If the coin lands head, you go for little black. If the coin lands tails, you go for little W. So what is it? So assume for a second that the real state is capital B. Your probability of getting the sausage is now 1/2, right? Because you throw the coin. If it is white, same goes. Okay, so when you don't know the odds, you can immunize your ignorance by tossing a coin. this opens an entire can of worms in terms of feedback and commitment, and we will leave the can of worms exactly closed. But, I mean, when you can first toss a coin, second, commit to the outcome of the coin, and this is another assumption. I know I'm throwing in many assumptions, but I will get somewhere. Okay? So, if you can throw a coin, second, commit to its outcome, and I will just say throw a coin to mean that it's not that you throw a coin and say, look, it said, add means that I should do B, well, I will throw it again. I mean, if you have a kid, you know that that's the way it goes. Okay, but anyway. So, this is why Lucy and Raifa say, they say it better than I do. They say, look, the security level of each act, a security level is what you get if things go wrong at night. The security level is zero, but when you randomize, the security level goes up to 1/2. Okay, what is the security level in this case? Your expected payoff. In that case, is the probability with which you get the food you want. Okay, so what happens? So actually, we are expanding by randomizing. We cannot. So we can, if you want to think of the problem, and this might also be just a rhetoric argument that we use to think about the problem rather than something that is feasible rather than conceivable. You may want to think about the problem and conclude, for example, that the two ways of getting the sausage are equivalent or not to you. You may want to conceive betting. Sorry, you may want to conceive randomizing. Okay? So you can say, look, I have to go this way or that way. Let me think. If I throw a coin, the two of them, the probability of getting what I want becomes the same in the two of them, and therefore they are indifferent. And somebody can say, and therefore they are not. But I mean, that's another story. But you can, I mean, thinking of randomization may help you thinking about the decision problem, whether or not randomization is actually feasible. Okay. Notice that what I told you is fix. Suppose I told you, assume that you throw a coin and fix a state. What happens? When you throw a coin and fix a state, you get a lottery here, right? It's as if you were throwing the coin between these two. You fix this state, and it's as if you are throwing a coin between these two. So what happens is that once you randomize actions, this randomization generates a randomization of lotteries conditional on states. Again, so assume that your randomization is alpha, and assume that the state is S, so you are conditioning on S. What is your probability of getting consequence C? Is the probability of the actions in capital A such that the outcome of the action in state S is exactly C. Okay, so notice that we are exactly, like Savage did, we are now building, again, acts. While in the case of Savage, how did you build an act in the case of Savage? In the case of Savage, you put an end there, right? An act is a function. Now, if you're randomizing an act, when you randomize here, an act is again a function, but it's no more a function from states to outcomes, but as I showed you before, is a function from states to lotteries of outcomes. Okay? This is the crux of the matter. I mean, the rest will be very easy. So please look there. Ask questions, don't be shy. It took a lot to us, I mean, it's very simple mathematically, stupid mathematically, but it took quite a bit to us to understand what was going on and why this was gonna be crucial. So, please, I mean, if you want to go on listening, I would just spend a couple of minutes looking at this. Questions? Okay, so let me wrap up again. So, you start with a decision problem, and you realize that the so-called pure actions correspond to functions from states to outcomes. And the so-called mixed actions corresponds to functions, but not from states to outcomes, but rather from states to lotteries over outcomes, where lotteries over outcome is a probability now on outcome, on the thing you care, not on the thing you use to get what you care. No, in fact, the name is Ascombe-Aumann Act. It's yes, okay, yes. Actually, Savage was not committal, so he just didn't tell you what were the outcomes. If you think that outcome are ipso facto frequencies, you are in this case. But the guys that said, look, an act, a generalized act, now, rather than going from states to consequences, goes from states to lotteries of consequences, the guys were Ascombe-Aumann. And they didn't think of this as a result of a randomization among action, but they thought about it as horses, and on the backs of the horses there were roulette wheels, and you bet on the horse, and when the horse wins, you spin the wheel. I mean, as much as I love them, I don't believe this story. I believe this story in a sense, and there are other important stories in which this happened. For example, in some geophysical problems. You know that some acceleration generates a rupture with some probability. So in that case, you really have outcomes that are frequencies, and it's a credible way of getting frequencies, not just an horse with a roulette wheel on its back. Okay, question again on this. Very well. So, mathematical properties, I mean, we could spend time on a debate about those, but because they have a meaning, it's discussed in, there is a working paper available on Bocconi's website. The meaning of this theorem in terms of decision is very much discussed there. I will be fast here. It tells you, look, the Ascombe-Aumann, remember, an Ascombe-Aumann act is a function from states to lotteries of consequences. An Ascombe-Aumann act generated by a pure action coincides with what? The Savage act. Why? Because in every state you get the consequence of the Savage act with probability 1. This is an important consistency check because this is telling you, just a second, no, Pier Paolo, during lunch.
No, what is delta?
Wait. Bravo. What is delta? Votes. Cast your votes. A Dirac measure. Grazie. Okay. Delta is a Dirac measure. So it's a probability that gives you one is the probability measure on consequences that gives weight 1 to the outcome of pure action A in state S and 0 to all the other outcomes, okay? And so you see that this is a Baroque way of looking at a Savage act, right? Because in every state, you get what you get with probability 1, okay? You get what you get. Hmm? And this is a consistency check between pure actions in the two, from the two point of views. Okay, this is gonna be Easter every day because this affinity of this mapping is what will allow us to take all the existent result. I mean, now I'm bullshitting. Most of the existing result written in the Ascombe-Aumann framework and translate them into the framework we are talking about. And this framework, in a sense, we think is more natural. So it tells you that the act induced by a, let me be sloppy, by a compound randomization is the composition of the two acts. Be careful. This is a mixed action, right? Because this is a convex combination of probability measures over A. And this is what, remember, X are function, they take value in a convex set, and convex combination is taking place in delta C. Okay, this has to do with ex ante, in some sense, with ex ante and ex post randomization. We will see it again, but mathematically, this will be the key. This is rather interesting because it tells you, look, when is it the case that all functions from S to delta C are generated by randomization of actions, if and only if you are in the original setup of Savage. In the original setup of Savage, all acts are conceivable. So all acts are conceivable, meaning that for every function from state to consequences, you can think of an action that delivers, that generates that act. This is, I mean, and this is Savage's assumption. Savage's assumption, this tells you, Savage's assumption corresponds to Ascombe-Hellman assumption under randomization. And that's the only case. In a sense, this will tell us that the framework in which we are working is always more parsimonious. And this is, and finally, remember that I've been suggesting you that you can eliminate, when I talked about reduction, you can paste together two lines that are equal, right? And if you have been playing around with game theory, you will be tempted to say, yes, but now this sounds like reduction of a normal form game, and so I want to start throwing away pure actions that are generated by mixed actions in the complement of their support. Because, I mean, you know game theory, yes, but that's game theory here doesn't help because it tells you that this can never be the case. If the problem is reduced, since you don't have money in the cells of the matrix, you have consequences, then it is the case that a mixed action is realization equivalent means that they generate the same, sorry, what is realization equivalent? It means that two different mixed actions are realization equivalent if in every state they give you the same distribution of consequences. Okay, if they generate the same Ascombe-Hellman act. Okay? So, sorry, this is important and I forgot. So, two mixed actions are realization. Remember, what you care about are consequences. Okay? And so this definition, which is basically inspired by Kuhn, tell you, look, two mixed actions that you can take are realization equivalent if in every state they give you the same distribution of outcomes. Is this clear? Okay, and this last line tells you that you cannot, if the problem is reduced, it may very well be the case that two mixed actions are realization equivalent without being equal. But it can never be the case that a mixed action is realization equivalent to a pure action, unless it is the Dirac concentrated on that pure action. So basically, it tells you that reduction, pure reduction, is as far as you can go. Okay. How much time do I have? 2 minutes?
20.
Well,
20 including.
Okay, question, please keep asking questions, I mean. So, remember that we are, I mean, look at the thing, but remember that I'm assuming commitment throughout. So the question is, will you see before the outcome of your toin cost, once you commit to the toin cost, or will you see before the state that realized it? Remember that you tied your end to the outcome of the toin cost, and then who cares, okay? That is a big slide that tells you, if you can commit, doesn't matter. Of course, if you can change when the information about the state and the randomizing device comes, becomes super important. But under commitment, it is completely irrelevant. And that's it. And this transparency basically is about this. And then, bene. Lotteries. What is a lottery? So first, remember that I told you, Marshak and Radner basically understood what you must conceive so that the modelist can extract what you like and what you think about the likelihood of events. And what is the reason? The reason is that in a Marshak-Radner framework, you can always conceive an action, let me call this action little c, big s, that irrespectively of the state give you consequence c. Okay, you can think it as an insurance, right? Maybe you cannot afford it, but so I buy an insurance and I tell you, look, give me a six eggs omelette, whatever happens, because otherwise I'm in trouble. And he tells me, give me 10 euros and I will make it so that whatever mess you do with the egg, I will just give you the ready-made omelette. Okay, so Marshak-Radner assumed that you can think of these things, meaning that these actions are conceivable. But if these are conceivable, then you, by mixing them, you will obtain distribution of outcomes that do not depend on the state, right? Because how do this action look? They have sausage, okay, or candy. So if you want this lottery, it's enough to mix a sausage action with a candy lottery. So in a Marshak-Radner framework, you can make an embedding of lotteries over consequences into mixed action. And how does the embedding work? You want to replicate this lottery over consequences, you just take this mixed action. And this is the mathematical, the math speak for that. Questions? Molto bene. Okay, and now you should have, you should really, really ask a question now. But why do we care about lotteries and act? You started now an hour ago talking to us about a decision problem, and you are just keep talking about acts and lotteries and not about actions. The reason is simple. First, using lotteries and following von Neumann-Morgenstern lead, we can get the utility of consequences. What does it mean on that blackboard? That you can replace, at this point, using lotteries, you can replace candies and sausages with numbers. And of course, mathematically speaking, this is a big boost. And the second boost is that now that you have numbers here, now acts become what? Become functions from states to numbers, the pure acts, or function from states to probability measures on the real line. So it's as if, fantastic, right? Because now meaning that the mathematical structure of your space is now a killer. You can do whatever you want because you have stochastic kernels. So what did decision theory do in these years? Said, look, a decision maker in general chooses among stochastic kernels. So this is where decision theory started and went on. So if you want, what I'm telling you is the prequel of the last 20 years of decision theory. Then I will give you in the remaining 20 seconds the last 20 years. But it doesn't matter, because once you have the prequel, then what happens makes a lot of sense and is very simple to see. Without the prequel, it still makes a lot of sense, but it's not equally easy, at least to me, to understand. Okay. Basta. Questions? Okay. So I could now give you just a reading list, because telling you, after 72, this is what happened. I will try just to wrap it up very quickly. So the decision maker preferences are represented as a binary relation on mixed actions. Again, this is meant to capture choice, not preference, meaning that in a sense preference is going to be on consequences. But there are good reasons to say guy chooses actions, and so the squiggle is the revealed preference of the decision maker among mixed actions. So now, using the embedding, you remember that little violet embedding, using the embedding, I can extract preference over lotteries. From preference over lotteries, I can extract a utility function and start cranking the machine. Questions? Okay, what do I call a rational preference? It is, I mean, I will have some explanation for using such a used word. It is complete and transitive. Completeness is not really important, but let's keep it. Transitive is, if you have a kid again, you know, it's not true that if he prefers A to B and B to C, he prefers A to C, but I mean, we are not kids, and the take is normative here. So it's complete. And second, if the lottery induced by mixed action A is better than the alpha, is better than the lottery induced by mixed action beta, in every state, I will want you to go for A rather alpha rather than beta. Okay? If you buy the thing that what you care about are consequences, the distribution of consequences induced by alpha is always better than the distribution of consequences induced by beta, irrespective of the state. And so you should, of course, as always, axioms you can read as shoulds with many quotes, go for A alpha rather than beta. And finally, on outcomes, the guy will satisfy von Neumann-Morgenstern axioms. We will call rational these things. For example, they are consequentialist, meaning that if A is realization equivalent, alpha is realization equivalent to beta, then they are indifferent. And they are rational in the sense, I mean, they satisfy some rationality requirements of game theory. For example, now that you have a little u that you extracted from risk preferences, you can say that a mixed action alpha dominates a mixed action beta if, for every state, the expected payoff induced by alpha is greater than the expected payoff induced by beta. Remember that now we have numbers there rather than candies and sausages. Okay, so in every state you can compute an expected payoff. And what are the dominant actions? Are the dominant actions. So if you have a set of if you are contemplating a set of strategies, it may be the very lucky case in which there are strategies that do better in every state. These are the dominant ones. Okay, and again, a big consistency check before starting the real thing is the following: what we call rational preference is any preference, turns out to be, any preference which is generated by a correspondence that satisfies a Rovian rationality and dominance. Okay? So what we termed, if you want, as axiomatical, we gave an axiomatic definition of rationality, and turns out to be just the joint of the definition of rationality of microeconomics and the one of game theory. I'm using big words here, but basically this is what the theorem says. Okay, so now I will just, 5 minutes, I will just try to run through the results, the very well-known results and not so very well-known results of the last 20 years. For example, okay, now this tells you that just continuity allow you to elicit. If you just add continuity to the assumption we made this far, this allows you to obtain a set of beliefs, not a single belief, but a set of beliefs that rationalize some of the choices of the decision maker. I will not go deeper, but there is everything you want in the working paper. For example, the max mean criterion of Milner, what does the max mean criterion of Milner tell you? It tells you, look, choose alpha over beta if the smallest expected payoff that you get with alpha is bigger than the smallest expected payoff that beta gives you. Meaning that you are thinking that there it's a very evil, very powerful, and all-knowing ghost. So he knows what you do and choose the states that hurts you the more. Okay? This is obtained with adding a very simple axiom that tells you if alpha doesn't dominate gamma, this is a lottery, this is a mixed, then the decision maker will take the lottery. Okay, Milner gave a theorem that looked like that, but in a different setup, and so he had sort of 10 axioms and matrices and whatever, but in this language it becomes very simple. Expected utility, this would be the definition of rationality of most of game theory. Add to the two, so take away caution now, and to rational preferences add independence. If you have independence, then rationality, continuity, and independence, there exists a belief on states such that you go for alpha rather than beta, if and only if. So think of what happens. You're mixing on the rows. You believe that nature is mixing on the columns. Okay, and so the two measures, your alpha here and nature's mu here, generate a product probability over there. Now you have payoffs and you just go for the maximum payoff. Okay, so this is just expected utility. Okay, this is the composition. So you compose a draw means take the matrix and replace food with numbers. The numbers that you get using von Neumann-Morgenstern axioms. And now take just the expected payoff. Okay. Here we don't even need a Marshak-Radner setup for this. And now I'm concluding basically. And then remember that at the beginning, some of you were actually not indifferent between these two things. And how do you write this lack of indifference in this setup? So in this setup, probably you were indifferent between little b and little w. And you preferred to bet on the, to take the coin. Okay? But the coin can be embedded in this mixed, which is realization equivalent, even if it is not equal, to the mixed of these two. Okay, which is, mathematically speaking, this mixed. All these tell you that for those of you that preferred the coin to the ghost, it means that what happened is that these two pure actions were indifferent, and each of them was the two pure actions in the matrix game were indifferent, but they were both dispreferred to the mixed. Axiomatically, this is the counterpart. Okay? So in a sense, it means that the lack of confidence on the likelihoods of the states lead you toward randomization. I told this now an hour and 15 minutes ago. Why? Because exactly we have seen that by randomizing you can immunize your ignorance about the likelihood because you can just annihilate the dependence on the outcome. Of course, this is sometimes the case and this is a big assumption. So what we have shown, and I will stop here, is that, let me recap a second, just a second. Caution gives you max min, okay? Independence gives you expected utility. Notice that uncertainty aversion is both consistent with independence, because independence implies uncertainty aversion, and with caution. Caution implies uncertainty aversion. So what we are giving you now is a cap, is an umbrella under which those are the two extrema, and we will be able to consider all the decision problem, all the behavioral features that range from extreme caution to independence. And basically, what we proved in 2011 is that take a rational preference, remember rational means blah, that is uncertainty averse and continuous. Continuity is, of course, needed for a number of reasons. Then there exists what? There exists a set of, let me call for a second, beliefs. I can discuss hours whether these things are beliefs, models, or what, but a set of beliefs that you might entertain over the likelihood of the events. That may be a singleton, and in that case, you are back to expected utility. That can be anything, and that you are back to to Milnor. And a function, which is a function of a reward function, which is a function of your mixed strategy, your mixed action, and nature's mixed action, such that you go for A over B if and only if this minimum is bigger than this minimum. And moreover, and most importantly, this function is an increasing transformation of your expected utility. So it is as if this decision maker were attributing to the ghost not one possible mixed strategy, but a set of mixed strategy. If he knew the strategy, he would maximize his expected utility. He doesn't know nature's strategy and acts in a cautious way, but not as, I mean, but the flexibility of the set small s and of the function capital U allow you to put under the same umbrella expected utility and max min. A very important form, I will not give you the axiom, but a very important form of the capital big U is when the increasing transformation of expected utility is just the identity. Okay? There is an additional axiom that is basically a cardinal uniqueness axiom that tell you if you add on top of that something that tell you that it doesn't matter whether you multiply numbers and blah, blah, blah there, then this is the form. And this is a very famous theorem of Gilboa and Schmeidler. I stop here.
We have a couple of minutes for questions, if there are any. Is this? Umberto.
Just a clarification. Back when you talked about this hiatus between the notion in game theory, the notion in game theory and in statistics. So I understand that if you have von Neumann-Morgenstern axioms and Savage axiom, you get the same mathematical representation. And from so you give numbers to sure. So it's before here. Okay, so you said there is a difference between the notion used in game theory and one used in statistics, right?
The one used in decision
theory. Yes, decision theory. Yeah, exactly.
Let me clarify the difference
I'm alluding at is the difference of what is meant by randomization. So in randomization in the decision theory of uncertainty, the one I'm referring to, basically the way in which the power of randomization was used and is used is conceiving actions as stochastic kernels, meaning conceiving actions as acts. In game theory, which is basically the approach is randomization as randomized strategies, which is exactly the take we have in this paper. In statistics, the idea is the idea of randomized tests. Okay, so you run an experiment, you see the outcome of the experiment, and then either you declare that something happens or not, either deterministically, and that's a non-randomized test, or then you see the outcome, and depending on the outcome of the experiment, you toss a coin to take a decision, but after seeing an experiment. Okay, so basically, the tree, if you draw them in a tree, randomization appears, let me be sloppy, exposed in an Ascombe-Hauman perspective, state and then consequences, ex ante in a game theoretic. Again, the take home of the one of the conclusions of the paper is that under commitment it doesn't matter, but the perspective in game theory is ex ante. And if you really have me say it, in randomized decision rule is in between. I will not use exinterim because it will my tongue, but in between. This is what I meant. Basically, they are not equivalent, but you can embed one in the other. Because basically, this is the so in the paper, there is a whole appendix about that. And actually, I like the appendix more than most of the paper, but I shouldn't say that in front of an audience. This result here basically tell you that the function that maps mixed strategy, let me call it strategy so that you get the right sound, that the mixed strategy, that the map that maps mixed strategies into the Ascombaumann acts is very well behaved. So it's not an embedding because it's not one-to-one, but it's a fine, and in a sense it's an immersion, which is exactly the trick that we use to use all the existing literature in this setup, in this older setup. And statistics is more delicate, big fun, appendix A of the working paper.
Not only you said that in front of an audience, but actually it's being live streamed and it's going to be recorded. You're doomed for this now. Yeah. Okay, so I suggest you take any other questions with you over lunch and ask Fabio. So let's thank him again for the tutorial. And